A few hundred years ago, there was a poet named Percy Bysshe Shelley who wrote a poem called Ozymandias. And he writes about how he met this traveler from an antique land who told of how he saw two vast trunkless legs of stone in the middle of a desert. And this vast statue of stone was all broken. It was a colossal wreck. And there was a visage, there was the head of the statue, this massive head of a statue of a king of ancient times, of days of eld and halcyon days of yore. He had this cold sneer of command, this haughty brow, this look of ferocity. He was a fierce and majestic and arrogant king with a sneer and a snarl playing on his lips. And when the traveler came upon this vast statue of this great king there in the desert, in the middle of nowhere, in the back of beyond, in the hinterlands, he saw that there was an epitaph, there was some words written next to this visage and bust and statue. And the words of this arrogant king with his head in the middle of the desert, this big statue, the words read, "My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Behold my works, ye mighty, and despair." And then Percy Bysshe Shelley ends the poem by saying, "And there was nothing around that colossal wreck save miles and miles of sand that stretched out in lone and level deserts." So what he was saying in this poem is, in ancient times, this great king builds a statue, has a statue built of himself. And with this sneer and an arrogant snarl on his visage and bust, the statue says, "I am Ozymandias, King of Kings. Behold my works, ye mighty, in despair." And now there's nothing around that colossal wreck except for a desert and a broken head and some vast trunkless legs. And that poem, when I heard it about a year ago, really spoke to me that even the greatest kings are wiped out by the dusts of history. Their names, even the greatest among them, the most arrogant among them, their names can be in water writ. And actually, it's interesting, the phrase "King of Kings" that Ozymandias used was invented by the Persians. It was then adopted by Alexander the Great and then hijacked by Paul the Apostle when he calls Jesus the King of Kings in the New Testament. But be that as it may, Jesus has a name unlike any other name. His name is one that every knee will bow to, every tongue will confess, whether in heaven, on earth, or under the earth, that everyone may give glory to God the Father, Philippians 2 says. So here's Jesus, who is a king who doesn't just have a memory in the sands of ancient deserts, a lone and level wilderness where there's just a bust that says, "I am Jesus, King of Kings, behold my works, ye mighty, in despair," and then he's forgotten about. Jesus' animating power is still at work to this day. This King of Kings leaves a Christ dimension within us so that we no longer live. We're crucified with him, but Christ lives through us. It's not just that his name is immortal. It's not just that his name is more renowned than Achilles. It's not just that his name is eternalized for all of posterity. It's that his animating force and spirit is still alive in people today. So at this hour, millions of men would still happily lay down their very lives and livelihood to serve him. He is a king unlike any other. And Romans 8:11 says, watch this, "The same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is alive in you to quicken your mortal bodies." This King of Kings, is this Christ dimension in you, is actually alive within you to quicken your mortal bodies, so that even when you feel like a colossal wreck, even when you were arrogant and cocky and you feel like Ozymandias, you're left in the deserts, the animating spirit of the Christ dimension rises you up to new levels and you raise up like a phoenix from the ashes, because the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is alive in you, so nothing can break you. In fact, trials just make you. They make you stronger. They make you mightier. And we get a share in his glory because we fellowshipped in his suffering. Come on. This is the power of Christ to this day. And I want to tell you that if you feel like you lifted yourself up in arrogance with the sneer of cold command and there's nothing left but a colossal wreck, the animating spirit of the King of Kings can raise your body and quicken it to an eternal and immortal and epic destiny worthy of any Homeric poem. Let's take a look at this in Psalm 62. David was in a place where no doubt he felt like a colossal wreck. He too, like Ozymandias and like his distant ancestor Jesus, was king, and a mighty king at that, a potent king at that. But unlike Ozymandias, he didn't have this arrogance or hubris, believing that he could navigate or negotiate the treacherous waters of existence or ruling over his empire and kingdom by his lonesome. He knew that he needed the help of the animating power of the ultimate king that he called the king over all the earth in Psalm 47. So this is to the chief musician, to Jeduthun, a psalm of David, starting in verse 1 of Psalm 62. He says, truly my soul waits silently for God. From him, from who? From him comes my salvation. The Bible says there is no other name under heaven by which men can be saved. So David says, my soul waits for the Lord. What does it mean to wait for the Lord? What does it mean to wait for the Lord? I have seen a lot of people say, and I've done this too, that they were waiting for God when really they were being lazy, lethargic, creating alibis, excuses, giving into fear in the name of waiting on God. That's not what he's talking about here. This waiting is not just it's not just a privative negation. It's not just an absence. What he's talking about here is an active waiting that literally means hope and trust lengthened. So that's what waiting means. When you see the phrase waiting on the Lord, it means hope and trust lengthened. I really love that definition. To wait on the Lord means, this is all it means, hope and trust lengthened. So you just stretch out hope and trust. That's what waiting is. Hope and trust lengthened. Hope and trust lengthened. That's what it means to wait for the Lord. Because it's easy to hope and trust in the Lord in a spontaneous combustion of internal fire in the moment. But what's difficult is to have that hope and trust lengthened over a long period of time. That's what it means to wait for the Lord. It's hope and trust lengthened. In fact, that's why Isaiah 40, 31, you know that famous verse that you all know? Those who wait on the Lord will mount up with eagle's wings like an eagle after molting. When it says those who wait on the Lord, some translations in the newer versions render it those who hope in the Lord. Because waiting and hoping in the Bible are synonymous and inextricably intertwined and even circuitous. You can interchange them. So waiting on the Lord is just hope and trust lengthened. It's saying, I'm going to hope and trust in you over a long period of time, over a lifetime, not just in a moment of inspiration when the muses are singing is the idea. And that's why the Bible says the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. It doesn't say the spontaneous momentary prayer, although that works too. Lord, save me, as Peter said when he was sinking into the abyss. Because to the Jewish people, the still waters were an abyss if they were not kinetic, but stagnant. Yes, sometimes just that simple prayer, Lord, save me, that's powerful. But the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Those who wait on the Lord, it's effectual, it's fervent. Hebrews 11, 6 says, without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that comes to God must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Diligently seeking him, effectual, fervent, hope and trust lengthened. That's what it means to wait on the Lord. Anybody can follow the Lord when the weather is fair, not foul. Anybody can worship the Lord when it's really sunny, not freezing cold on the final Sunday morning of the amphitheater season. That's very easy to do. But Jesus said, what king would go to battle against an army of 20,000 troops if he only has 10,000 troops without first counting the cost? What man would build a tower if he only had enough funds and fiscal financing to only give backing to the foundation, but he can't build the whole tower? Jesus said, so too, you must count the cost. It requires waiting. It's effectual. It's fervent. It's diligent. It's hope and trust lengthened. It's patient. That's the idea of waiting on the Lord, and that's how you renew your strength. It's interesting, Lamentations chapter 3, I've been meditating on this yesterday. I want to read this to you. It's verse 25 through 30. It says, the Lord is good to those who wait for him. Say, I don't feel like the Lord is good. That's because you're not waiting. You're looking at your moment right now. You're like, this is a bad moment. This is a bad season. No, it says the Lord is good to those who wait for him. Hope and trust lengthen. If you feel like the Lord's not good, it's because you're not waiting. The Lord is good to who? To those who wait for him. It goes on to say, to the soul who seeks him. Again, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man, those who diligently seek him. It is good that one should hope and wait quietly. So there's hope and waiting, again, as sort of Hebrew parallelism. synonymous. It is good that one should hope and wait quietly. Just as he says in verse 1 of our psalm, truly my soul waits silently for God. This says it is good that one should hope and wait quietly for what? For the salvation of the Lord. Why? Because the psalmist says, I find my salvation in the Lord. So evidently Jeremiah was probably getting his inspiration from this psalm because it's very similar. Verse 26 of Lamentations 3 goes on to say, it is good that one should hope and wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for a man to bear the yoke in his youth. Let him sit alone and keep silent because God has laid it on him. Let him put his mouth in the dust. There may yet be hope. So instead of running around whining and panicking, just wait quietly. It's all going to work out. Put your mouth in the dust while there is still hope. It is good that a man should bear the yoke in his youth, that you go through hard stuff in your early years so that you can enjoy the benefits of your later years of the difficult stuff you went through in your salad days, as Shakespeare would say. In other words, we do what others won't do today so we can have what others can't have tomorrow. Let me say that again. We do what others won't do today so we can have what others can't have tomorrow. We do what others won't do today so we can have what others can't have tomorrow. We put our mouth in the dust. We wait silently, quietly, trust and hope lengthened, fervent, effectual, diligently seeking him. And the Lord is good to those who do that. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to those who hope in his mercy. Eat your vegetables first, have your dessert after. Preferably don't have your dessert at all, but I'm just saying. And then your reward is physical health. But be that as it may, whatever you want to do. He says, it's good that you bear the yoke in your youth. Like, do the hard stuff first. You do what others won't do today so you can have what others can't have tomorrow. Hope and trust lengthened. It requires waiting, waiting, waiting. Maybe you don't think God is good because you're not waiting. Who is the Lord good to? Those who wait. Just wait it out. God will prove to be good. He'll prove to be good. Verse 2. Look at that word. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. I quoted this verse last week, but I love this psalm. I shall not be greatly moved. Listen to his adjuncts, his attributions that he is ascribing to the divine. He says, he is my rock when the vicissitudes of life are always changeable and life is a roller coaster and fluid. He is my rock. When I feel like I'm a colossal wreck as Ozymandias, he is my salvation, the King of Kings. When I need a defense attorney, an advocate, he is my defense, as 1 John says, as verse 2 says. Therefore, none of these things move me, as Paul said to the Ephesian elders. I shall not be greatly moved. Kind of reminds me of Psalm 18, verse 2. In Psalm 18, verse 2, listen to what David says. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, my refuge, my shield, my horn, my salvation, and my stronghold. Some people say like I pack a lot of content into a short amount of time, probably too much. But look at what David does there. Talk about packing a lot of monikers into one verse. In one verse, he says two times, the Lord is my rock. He calls him his rock twice in one verse. He says, the Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, my refuge, my shield, my horn, my salvation, my stronghold. Whatever you're going through today, just let me say this over you a few more times, that verse. Just whatever you're going through today, listen to what Psalm 18:2 speaks of the one who is your defense, the Lord. He is your rock, your fortress, your deliverer, your refuge, your shield, your horn, your salvation, your stronghold. He's your rock, your fortress, your deliverer, your refuge, your shield, your horn, your salvation, your stronghold. That's who he is. That's who he is. I'm going to say it again. I just love it. For me, I love this. He is your rock, your fortress, your deliverer, your refuge, your shield, your horn, your salvation, your stronghold. If you feel like the world is inimical and hostile to your very being, and it's like sulfuric acid raining from the skies as if you lived on Venus, and you feel like this planet is like breathing methane and you're not even supposed to be here, a pilgrim, a sojourner, this is not your home, and you're going through many a trial and tribulation, just remember the Lord is your refuge. When there's fiery arrows zooming all around you, the Lord is your refuge, and that is where your strength is. That's where your strength is. He is your horn, your salvation, your rock, your fortress, your deliverer, your defense. That's who he is. Verse 3. How long will you attack a man? You shall be slain, all of you, like a leaning wall and a tottering fence. Like a leaning or bloated or bulging wall that eventually will collapse under the weight of its own gravity. Or like a tottering fence that is, Song of Solomon says, even a little fox can walk on a tottering fence and it collapses. So too, David says, that's how the wicked who are attacking me will be. They'll be like a leaning wall and a tottering fence. In fact, I wasn't planning to say this part. I do want to say David was ruthless in how he prayed about his enemies. Now, I like to spiritualize this because Jesus told us to bless our enemies in prayer and, you know, pray against the forces of darkness, principalities, powers, spiritual wickedness in high places, the hierarchy of demonic activity or psycho-spiritual, the fortitude of darkness, fortresses of the abyss. At the same time, when people really wrong you, I don't think it's wrong to talk to God and say they are a leaning wall and a tottering fence. Like I don't think God's like, they are. When you're like, God, can you believe what he said about me? God's not like, really? That's a juicy deet piece of gossip that I can't believe. Like now I'm gonna look at him way differently. No, all things are naked and exposed before God. And to be truthful, emotions denied breathing room affect intellectual, mental, and physical performance. Research tells us, and if you're not allowing cathartic, therapeutic breathing room, sometimes you got to go in the presence of God and say, God, my and these people, like even people, are a tottering wall and a bloated fence. I didn't used to think that. I used to always spiritualize it, and I think it is important to spiritualize it. But at the same time, it's actually very healing because if you don't get out the feelings that you have of vitriol in the presence of God, it's going to come out later in very different contexts that you wish it didn't come out in those scenarios. You know, like if you don't pour out your heart to God, whatever's in there regarding other people, the next time you see that person, it might come out in front of others and you're going to be embarrassed and ashamed. But you're not going to be ashamed if you go to the Lord and you say, Lord, these people are a tottering fence and a bulging wall. Anyway, I think it's interesting how he says, how long will you attack a man? Verse 3. I'm reading out of the New King James today, but the Old King James says, how long will you imagine mischief? Is that right? Does yours say, how long will you imagine mischief? Did you know that is the only time the word imagine in the original Hebrew is used here? So in the original etymological language, the word here translated imagine, or in my New King James attack, it's the only time that word is used in the Old Testament in Hebrew. And the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, Hebrew scriptures, renders that word rush. How long will you imagine mischief? Or how long will you attack a man? It literally means how long will you rush against a man? Now, if you like football, you know how the running back, Todd Gurley III or the second or however many lineage generations he goes down. When Todd Gurley III is running the ball, he is rushing at the linebackers. He is rushing at the defensive ends. He's rushing at the nose guard. So too, that can be how it is. People can rush against you. But the good thing is you have a really good lineman who's your defense. He's the rock of ages and he is immovable. Therefore, we will not be moved. Amen. Verse 4. They only consult to cast him down from his high position. They delight in lies. They bless with their mouth, but they curse inwardly, Selah. Have you ever encountered people who bless with their mouth and they're liars? You're like, I know you're flattering me with your tongue, but behind my back, you're saying something totally different. You're flattering me with your tongue, but there's another part to the story that you're not telling me that's going on in your heart. There are people who will do that. But I want to encourage you. Would you look up at Psalm 61, verse 2 real quick? It's just one chapter up. What do you do when people consult to cast you down from your high position? When people delight in lies, when they bless you with their mouth, but inwardly they're cursing you, they're flattering you with the tongue, but their heart is far from you. Look at what Psalm 61 verse 2 says. From the end of the earth, I will cry to you. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Is your heart overwhelmed because of other people? When you cry out to God from the ends of the earth, from the island of the sirens, from Babylonian, Assyrian, Chaldean captivity, when you have to look toward Jerusalem because you're stuck in a strange and foreign land and you pray three times toward the temple, but you're in an alien country, from the ends of the earth, wherever you are, when you're stuck in White City. Actually, White City, they're doing renovations. It's actually looking very good. From the ends of the earth, wherever you are, you cry out to the Lord. And listen, when your heart is overwhelmed, God will lead you to a rock that is higher than you. Like, I'm like a, my awareness is the sky, everything else is the weather. And I am suddenly perched up higher and I'm watching all these emotions come and go, all these circumstances come and go, all these situations, troubles come and go. And I'm at a rock higher than I am. So when people try to cast me down from my high place, nobody can reach me at the rock that is higher than I. When my heart is overwhelmed, I cry out to the Lord and he leads me to the rock that's higher than I am. Even when people are consulting to cast you down from your high position and delighting in lies. It's interesting, in history, King Philip said that he could sleep securely because his friend Antipater was watching over him. So King Philip said, I can sleep securely. As long as my friend Antipater is beside me, watching over me, standing guard, I can sleep securely. In the same way, that's precisely what we can say. We have an almighty friend. That's one of my favorite phrases of God. The almighty friend, who the psalmist said, he is my keeper. He neither slumbers nor sleeps. He's watching out for you. He's watching over you. He's standing watch against the enemy who would rush against you or imagine mischief upon you. He's the rock that's higher than you are. Verse 5, my soul waits silently for God alone. Are you following this? Verse 5, Psalm 62, my soul waits silently for God alone, for my expectation is from him. If your I'm going to tell you a little secret about life right now that the Bible shows us. If your expectation is from someone else, be prepared to be disenchanted. If your expectation comes from God alone, it might not always be what you thought. It might not be how you expected things to work out. It might not even be the exact result you were looking for. But what you will always find is when your expectation comes from him alone, when you wait silently for the Lord, from him, salvation and rescue and deliverance will come. From him, power, safety, security will come. From him, you will find the ability to be safe because he is your rock, your fortress, your deliverer, your refuge, your shield, your horn, your salvation, your stronghold, your defense, the rock that is higher than you are. That's who he is. Now notice, he says, from you alone comes my expectation. Do you know how powerful you would be if all your expectation just came from God? The Bible says, vain is the help of man. Now, it's good. I love to have people around me that advise me and the multitude of counselors there is safety. I love to have people that I can go to share my burdens. The Bible says, share one another's burdens. But when all is said and done, when you force the moment to its crisis, as T.S. Eliot said, when you force the moment to its crisis, if your expectation comes from God alone, you're going to be indomitable. Like, you're going to be so powerful that nobody can bring you down. No enemy can force you down. No evil spirits that rush against you or imagine mischief upon you. Nobody can take you down because the Lord only is your rock. Now watch this. Jesus said, wise is the builder who builds his house on the rock and not on the sand, because when the storms come and the winds rise, the house will collapse if it's built on the sand. But I don't know if you've ever been around quicksand. I haven't. I just read about this in a book. But apparently, if you put one foot on a rock and the other foot on quicksand, you will sink into the quicksand just as surely as if you had both feet in the quicksand. So if you have one foot on a rock and the other foot on quicksand, you're going to fall into the quicksand and sink just as surely as if you had both your feet in the quicksand. Wise is the person who realizes that people are quicksand, that circumstances are quicksand, that riches are quicksand, that the military help of man is quicksand. If you're kind of half trusting in other de facto saviors and half trusting in the rock, you're going to sink into depression. You're gonna sink into the quicksand. You're gonna sink into what the psalmist called the miry clay. But when you put both feet on the rock that is higher than you are, and sometimes it's not even for anything specific. You just say like Jehoshaphat, I don't know what to do, my eyes are on you. And you put both, yes, we need specificity in prayer and intentionality, but sometimes we just say, Lord, I am flinging all my weight upon you. When you put both your feet on the rock and you say, from him alone comes my salvation. When I wait quietly for him alone, my expectation is from him, nothing can bring you down. Because listen, God is a rock that's higher than you are. Okay, now saying this, I realize that a lot of you are like, yeah, that's fine in theory. But I wonder if there's a few people here who will actually take this to a whole other level and say, you know what? I have not really been trusting in the rock. I've been half trusting in quicksand and half trusting in God. And I don't know why I'm a double-minded man, unstable in all my ways. Instead, I need to say, my feet are planted on the rock. I'm digging in my heels. Nobody can shake me. None of these things move me. I cannot be stopped. I'm invincible. I'm indomitable because the Lord is my rock, my refuge, my salvation, my horn, my defense, my shield. That's who he is. So none of these things move me. Come on. Our expectation comes from him. He alone, when we wait for him quietly, trust and hope lengthened. When we do this, the quicksand can't get us, which is awesome. Which is awesome. Isaiah 45:22, this is what God says. Look to me and be saved, for I am God, there is no other. Let me read that again, Isaiah 45:22. Look to me and be saved, for I am God, there is no other. All you ends of the earth. Look to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth, for I am God, there is no other. That's exactly what David's saying. He's saying, if God will not help me, none else shall. You will see some of the most powerful prayers answered when you say, if God, if you don't help me, none else shall. My expectation is from you. You alone are my rock. Verse 6, I'm actually ending on time today, and you don't have any idea how happy I am. I think the cold makes me like go quicker. Verse 6, he only is my rock. Are you seeing what David keeps saying? My expectations from him. My soul waits for him alone. He only is my rock. Verse 2, he said the same thing. He only is my rock. He's repeating that refrain. He's like, it's both my feet are on the rock. Do you see what he's saying here? James said, you can't be a friend of the world and a friend of God. If you're a friend of the world system and a friend of God, you a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways, a kingdom divided against itself can't stand. He says, he only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. Watch this. I shall not be moved. Okay, look up at verse 2. He says almost the same thing, but look at the difference. Look up at verse 2. He says, he only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. He uses the adverb greatly, but then in verse 6, he says, he only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be moved. So now he takes out the word greatly. At the beginning of his prayer, he's like, you know what? God's my rock, my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. But as he gets a little further into his prayer, he says, the Lord only is my rock. He is my defense. I shall not be moved, period. He takes out the word greatly. So his faith is actually strengthened through trials. His faith is made stronger by trials. The further exercise of his trust is manifested, the deeper into the prayer he goes. Because at first he's like, you know what? I won't be moved too bad. And then he's like, actually, I'm not going to be moved at all. First he's like, you know, I won't be greatly moved. But as he prays more, he's like, actually, I'm not going to be moved at all, period. Like at first it's like, I might wobble a little bit, but I'm sure I'll keep find my sea legs and keep my footing. But the more into the psalm he goes, he's like, actually, I'm not going to even vibrate at all. I'm not going to move at all. I'm not going to tremble at all. That's what happens when you pray. Powerful stuff. Verse 7, in God is my salvation and my glory. The rock of my strength and my refuge is in God. Like David really knows what he thinks about God. He doesn't understand why men imagine mischief against him or why the tottering fence and the bulging fence, the leaning wall, why they attack him, these people. He doesn't understand why the fiery arrows are about to pierce him, but what he does know is that the Lord is his refuge. I'm not telling you to have all the answers today. I think if you're going through suffering and somebody's like, here's A, B, and C, 100% this is why you're going through your problems, I'd be very suspicious of that. I'm not a subscriber or prescribed to duality. I believe in infinite complexity. I can't tell you exactly why you're going through what you're going through. I don't have all the answers for you, but this is what I do know. I do know that no matter what you're going through today, the Lord will be your refuge. I think of Petra from Indiana Jones and the Book of Revelation, pick your poetic poison. But like it's a rock in the middle of a desert. When you're besieged by fears on all sides, David said, I will not be afraid of 10,000s who surround me on all sides. If 10,000 or if 1,000 fall on my right and 10,000 fall on my left, the Lord is my refuge. The presence of God will be a refuge. You say, well, how do I access this refuge? Through hope and trust lengthened, you express your prayers, your supplications, your hopes, your fears, your dreams in the presence of God. You talk to God. You wait silently for him. He will be your refuge in the war. That's who he is. Through these adjuncts and attributions, he helps his own faith. He quells the commotions of his headstrong affections by praising God. Can I tell you, when we praise God, it's not just for his sake. God's not like, oh, I need to have my ego stroked like Ozymandias so I can maintain my sneer of cold command. We need to praise God for our own soul because it quells the commotions of our headstrong affections when these adjuncts and attributions help our faith when we express who the Lord is. It actually strengthens our own trust in that moment. You tracking with me, guys? Verse 8. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Refuge, 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 refuge. That's what the Lord spoke to me on a prayer time the other day. I was in this like desert area praying. I love this desert area. It was next to Walmart, so it's not really a desert. But like it feels like it. And the Lord, there was like a little tiny river that flowed in the desert, like there will be streams in the desert. And the Lord's like, Ben, I'm your refuge. I'm your refuge. He's your refuge. That's who he is. That's what the Lord is speaking to. I'm your refuge. You don't have to have answers for why everything's happening. Like, for example, I told you that my friend Jared killed himself, and that's been very confusing for me because he was in the ministry and doing Hope Anthem and speaking and doing similar things that I'm doing in his own way. And I don't understand why that happened. I don't have answers always. But like the Lord spoke to me, Ben, I'm your refuge. I'm your refuge. You don't have to have all the answers. I'm your refuge. In fact, trust God when you don't even have a pawn. When you don't even have a pawn left on the chessboard, you're like, I'm still going to trust you. In the words of Job, watch this. Even if he slay me, yet will I trust him. Another translation says, yet will I hope in him. Even if he slay me. Ready for this? I'm going to try to take your faith to a new level. If you're here and you're saying, I want to, like the disciples pray, increase my faith, then watch this. Trust in a killing God. I'm not saying he is killing you, but it feels like it. Job said, even if he slay me, yet will I trust him, for I know that my Redeemer lives, for in my flesh I will see God. It wasn't that God was killing Job. In fact, it was the enemy actually who was taking away Job's health. And Job did survive the crisis. He didn't even die. But at the moment, it felt like God was killing him. Even if you think God's killing you, he's not slaying you. But even if it feels like it, say, fine, I'll trust in a killing God. What's the enemy going to do to you then? How is fear going to even touch you then? How are you even going to have anxiety or worry when you're like, God, you might be slaying me right now, and I have no answer to that. Nevertheless, even if you kill me, even if you slay me, yet will I trust you. Because in my flesh, I will see God, my Redeemer lives. No wonder Job was the greatest, most godly man in the East. He was the most godly man in the East. What Kawhi Leonard was to the East, isn't he in the West now with the LA Clippers? That's what Job was to the Eastern Conference. He was the most godly man of the East. Yet he said, even if he slay me, I trust in it. Fine, I know God is love, and I know that in my flesh I'll see God. But let's just say he's a killing God. Fine, where else can I go? You alone have the words of eternal life. Like you're the prime mover, the principle behind which you cannot go, the causeless cause, the creator of the initial singularity. Like where else am I gonna go? Am I gonna call my grandma? Like what am I gonna do? Where else can I go? Like if I have to trust in a killing God, fine. that kind of faith, like the kind of faith where you say, I trust in a killing God, even if he slays me. FYI, he's not killing you. He's not slaying you, but you might feel like it, just as Job thought God was slaying him, but he wasn't. If you have that kind of faith, you watch how eventually you're going to get twice as much as you had before, because he only was your rock. If you don't help me, none else shall. Wow. Lamentations. Oh, this is great. Watch this. Lamentations 2 verse 19. Watch this. Watch this. This is huge. You got to get this. We're really almost done, but it's, and we're on time, so we're okay. Give me 4 minutes. Lamentations 2:19 says, pour out your heart to God like water. Okay, that's what Lamentations 2:19 says. Pour out your heart to God like water. What does this verse say? Trust in him at all times. Even when he seems to be a killing God, even if it seems like he's slaying you, don't just trust him when things are good. Trust in him at all times, all you people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Pour out your heart before God. What does that look like? Lamentations 2:19 expounds upon this. He says, pour out your heart like water. Like water. Not like oil, but like water. Oil was what was used to anoint people and come upon them. But water, what was, came upon people to anoint them in the Bible. But water came through people and out of them like torrents of living water gushing forth from your belly. John 7. So oil in the Bible is something that comes upon you, anointing. Water is something that comes through you, torrents of living water bursting out of your belly. Are you tracking with that? And here's why that's important. Because if you've ever tried to pour oil out of a vessel, it sticks to the sides. It sticks to the sides. It's like molasses. It's slow and it's sticky. It's like almost like glue, like runny glue. But water just pours right through. When you dump out a vessel, it wills out every drop if it's water you're talking about. Your prayer time should not be pouring out oil. It should be pouring out water. Oil is something that comes upon you. Water is something that pours through you. Torrents of living water, this spake ye of the Holy Spirit. When you pray in the Spirit, watch this. It's super important that you will out every drop. So you say, I still have frustrations. I still have stuff I can't figure out. I still have these things on my heart. Pour out your heart to God till you're exhausted. And you're like, every drop of my heart is out. I poured it out like water. Like, God, there's nothing in my heart hid from you. I talk to you about everything until your voice gets hoarse if you need to, especially if you're going through something difficult. Like, pour out your heart to God like water. Trust in him at all times. Don't just say, well, I prayed a little bit and I didn't feel better. Like, keep praying. Just keep pouring it out. I still have this and that. God's not like, man, I'm tired of hearing. No, his arm is not too short to save. His ear is not too dull to hear, the Bible says. He's one of the few people who you can't talk too much to him. I talk the ear off everybody. You're like, we know. But God, no, you're gracious. But God, he's never like, gosh, you talk way too much, Ben. No, pour out your heart. He invites you to do this like water, not like oil. Don't let it stick. Sometimes we pray like, well, I got a few things out in prayer. No, get will out every drop, every emotion. Verse 9, surely men of low degree are a vapor. Men of high degree are a lie. If they are weighed together on the scales, they are altogether lighter than vapor. I know David Hume and the humanist wouldn't like me saying this, but I have to say it because I think there's a truth to this. David said, there is no one good. So you eventually live enough life and you're like, men of high degree, they're a lie. Men of low degree are a vapor. Vain is the help of man. Yes, there are people who choose the light over the dark, and I'm going to run with those people. But at the same time, you start to find when you live enough life, people just tend to do some pretty unspeakably nefarious, awful things. And wise is the stoical man or woman who says, I'm not going to be surprised anymore. They are a vapor. They are a vapor. The Lord is my refuge. I'm not going to cling to the creature. The creature lies. The creature is never true to those who trusted in them. The creator is always constant, faithful. Notice how he says they are a vapor. If you have the old King James, it says the word vanity, does it not? Men of high degree and low degree are vanity. The word in the original Hebrew language means a vain, light thing. The picture is of a breath from the mouth or a bubble on water. So picture a breath of a mouth or a bubble on water. Is that what you want to trust in? Good luck. If you say, I'm going to stand on the bubble on the water, or I'm going to ride the breath from the mouth, it's like, it's vanity. It's not something solid. Verse 10, do not trust in oppression nor vainly hope in robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them. I don't know if you have a lot of like wit and intelligence, a lot of wealth and money, a lot of power, and you can throw your political weight around. Eventually you find all that stuff at the end of the day, it's wood, hay, and stubble. It goes away. Don't trust in oppression, ill-gotten gains, nor hope in robbery, thievery. If riches increase through just means, don't even trust in them. Don't put your heart on them. Why? Because the Bible says in the book of Proverbs that money has wings like an eagle. It flies away, which is really funny because whoever designed our dollar bill put an eagle on it, which is a fulfillment of the Proverbs prophecy that money is like eagles. It has wings. It flies away. If you don't believe me, apparently just have kids and then it's supposed to just fly away. I don't have kids, so I don't know. But like an eagle isn't gonna like chase after flies. It's only gonna soar if it sees game. In the same way, don't chase after like a dog chasing after a flea, as David said to Saul. If you're living your life to get money, you're gonna be a very vain vapor, like water on a bubble, breath of a mouth kind of person. You're just not gonna have a lot of substance to you. And he says, basically he's saying, the truly rich man loves his riches poorly. The truly rich man loves his riches poorly. You're like, God, thank you that you gave me these blessings, but help me not to trust in them. Thank you for giving me wit, intelligence, wealth, power, acumen, but at the end of the day, Lord, it's all vain. Unless I'm trusting in you. If I'm seeking first the kingdom, I can enjoy all these things. But if I'm living for all these other things, I'll miss the kingdom and be disenchanted by the very things I was trusting in. Verse 11 and 12 are ending. God has spoken once, twice have I heard this, that power belongs to God. Also to you, O Lord, belongs mercy, for you rendered each one according to his work. David closes the psalm by saying, and we end here, Lord, there's two things I know, simplicity after complexity. I have not looked over here at all. How are you guys doing? You guys doing okay? Okay, you guys look bright and sunny here in the cold shade. The Lord is the shade at your right hand. He says, after all of this, like this deep theological poetry, prayer musing, he says, Lord, there's two things I know about you. You're strong and you're merciful. Is God all powerful or is God all loving? According to David, he's both. Well, I don't have all the answers. You have enough answers, the kind of answers you need. He's a refuge for you. And one day you'll know even as you are known, but right now we walk by faith even when we don't have all the queries and conundrums puzzled out and riddled out and solved. You're strong and you love me. Do you know there were two pillars in the temple? One was named Jachin and the other was named Boaz. Jachin means certainty. Boaz means there is strength within him. I was literally just studying about this yesterday. Strength within him was one pillar of the temple, Boaz, and Jachin was the other, which means certainty. Those are the two pillars of my life. Certainty, God is for me. He loves me and strength is within him. There is power. My heart for you as your younger brother, in many cases, as your older brother for some of you, children. Life is all about God. Like, really. This is not something I'm saying hypothetically. I hope you can tell through my teaching. Like, this is something I really try to live. Not perfectly. I still trust in people way too much, but I want to get there. But, like, this is real. Have this kind of Davidic relationship with God. I don't even like David, to be honest with you. He committed adultery, like, killed a guy to cover it up. Like, was just a horrible dad. I don't even like him. The fact that the Bible calls him a man after God's own heart, it's like, shows me how nice God is, not how great David is. That's just my opinion. The guy was like, not my favorite guy, honestly. But the one thing I can say about this guy is he really loved God, and I want that kind of love for God. And what he's writing is true. This is it. The Lord is strong. He is your refuge. He is your fortress. He is your salvation. He is your horn. He is your defense. He's the stone that is higher than you are. He is for you. He's not against you. And when you kneel before God, God will stand up for you. When God stands up for you, no one can stand against you. When men rush against you and imagine vain mischief upon you, when people seem like a bubble on water or a breath from the mouth, God will be your secure, firm foundation. So you continue to walk with him closely, love him deeply, follow after him ardently, trust in him passionately. He will not fail you. He will not let you down. Even when everything seems to be falling apart, when you trust in God, he causes it to start falling into place because he is the rock, the refuge, the Jachin, the Boaz, the pillars, the certainty. There is strength in him. So trust in him all of your days. Come on. That's what we're going to live for. That's what we're going to live for. In Jesus' name.